clouds rolling. I can feel the wind as they try to shake me. I will not be moved. My feet are on the rock. Ooh, I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fears won't hold me now. My feet are on the rock.
When I feel my heart about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain.
Let's stand and sing this next song together.
No greater hope I know, no greater joy I know. you know we're in the midst of royalty. Rakesha has won. What was the pageant? I'm so proud of you.
Thank you. Senior Miss Juneteenth 24.
Senior Miss Juneteenth 24. We knew she was beautiful, and we know she can sing. But I think that's wonderful. I think it is. Welcome to worship here at the Invitation, in-house and online. We are grateful that you chose this day to worship with us. If you would join me in a call to worship. Friends, we gather to worship, grateful for God's presence in this world. We gather to worship, humbled by God's presence in our lives. We gather to worship in response to God's invitation into relationship. We gather to worship to go back to the basics of our lives as faithful people, to be reminded to do no harm, to be empowered to do good, and to be free to stay in love with God. So be it. Let us worship. If you would be seated, and let's pray together. God, open our hearts and our spirits to hear your healing words of peace and love, O God. Help us be the people of service and justice that you have called us to be. Make us ready to heal rather than harm, to serve rather than sever. Give us hearts of joy and justice, for we offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, we have several announcements, you know, because we like announcements, but some of them are important and y'all need to listen. We have a children's musical coming up called Storm on May the 1st. We will have a family night barbecue after that, but the kids have been working really, really hard. And so it will start at 6 here, and then we'll be on the CLC lawn for a fun time together. So I'd love y'all to come to that if you can, and if your children are in it, thank you for letting us have your children on Wednesday afternoons. We've replaced 120 hymnals in the sanctuary. So the ones that we replaced, the other ones are in Wesley Hall if you would like a free hymnal. I know sometimes we've been told people like a hymnal if they're worshiping at home. It helps them follow along better. So those are there if you'd like those. What's Up Wednesday this week, we have Tupelo High School robotics team will be here, and several of our children are on, or our teenagers are on that. And so we welcome you for 5 o'clock for dinner, and then for a presentation from them. I think they've just recently won a contest, and I was gonna look it up and I've forgotten. But anyway, they are they're really, really good, and it'll be great being with the kids. Baccalaureate is May the 12th. And May the 19th is confirmation service. We meet with the confirmands this afternoon, so if that involves you, if you could have them here at 5, we'll go through some things with them. And we're so excited for them to join our church. They joined when they were baptized, but this is just the next step in being United Methodist so that they can publicly profess their faith to you. Now, if there are no more announcements, nobody else, if you would stand and greet your neighbor in Christian love. Thank y'all so much for being here.
Good morning, everyone. Let's continue worship.
Woke up this morning, saw the world full of troubled mind. How'd ever get a devil confined? How's it gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. I thought disgusted me. So I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. I created you. If not us, then who? If not me and you? Right now, it's time for us to do something. If not now, for us to do something. So tired of talking about how we are God's hands and feet. It's easier to say than to be. We're like angels of empathy. Tell ourselves it's alright, somebody else will do something. But I'm sick and tired. Life with no desire. I won't be the flame, I wanna be a fire. I wanna be the one who stands up and says, I'm gonna do something. If not us, then who? If not me and you, right now, it's time for us to do something.
Holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Oh.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice. Ocean, so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now.
Jireh, you are enough. Jireh, you are enough. I will be content in every circumstance.
Dear friends, I invite you to continue standing as I share this morning our gospel lesson. It comes to us from John's gospel, the 10th chapter. Hear now the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. The wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. But I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold, and I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father, the Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I invite you to listen to the words of this song by Chris Tomlin, how he expresses how good of a shepherd our Savior is to us.
Savior leads me. Who have I to ask beside? How could I doubt his tender mercy? Who through life has been my guide? All the way my Savior leads me, cheers each winding path I tread, gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. Lord, you keep me from falling.
Hey, Fong. As though we didn't just walk up here together. I don't know. That's what it says here, right?
Right. You wrote it.
I want to let you know how thankful I am for our church. And from the bottom of my heart, I truly am thankful. You know, it means a lot to me to come here. It's a place of solitude. It's a place where I can go to. And just like a lot of folks in this room, Morgan and I, we raised our kids here. We have a lot of fond memories and important events in our lives that happened here. But also, they happened because of our faith as we were taught it here. But I got to ask you something. So what is all this conversation about the Wesleyan way of living? Others probably feel that way in the room today. I mean, I know about John Wesley, but what exactly does Wesleyan way of living mean?
John Wesley gave us three simple rules that he said if we would follow, that our lives would be better and our church would be better. Do no harm, do good, and stay in love with God. And so the Wesleyan way of living is to try to keep those ways that we've been given. It's pretty simple, but it's pretty not simple when we start actually doing and looking at things that do harm. Mm. And how do we do good? Mm-hmm. In 1 John 3, verse 16, in that passage of Scripture, Jesus shows us how to do these things. Jesus showed us everything that we need to know about love, and that's what we're talking about today. What does do love mean? Jesus died for us, and we should lay down our lives for each other every day. I hope it doesn't involve a cross for you, but that was the ultimate sacrifice that Jesus gave us because he loves us so much. So when we think about that, when we see somebody in need, if we love others, if we want to do good, how do we just walk by? What can we do to help their life better? Something that we feel in our hearts. It's something, do good causes us to be a heart thing, to stay in love with God. Amen.
I get it. I always used to tell my kids, Jesus lives in your heart.
Yes.
And, you know, I get it. It's a heart-conscious thing. When we do the right thing, when we do good, we're filled with this awareness of God working in our hearts. And we also have a boldness to love others as God loves others.
Renee, I think you've got it. You're so smart. Right. The message that God provides to all of us is this, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another just as we've been commanded to. Is it going to be easy? It's not. But we are still called not to quit and to keep trying to do good and to try to stay in love with God and to treat each other well. We're told that anyone who obeys what God has told us to do, that they have God in their hearts, and that heart conscious, that thing is really important. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Thank you, Renee and Fawn. Well, they just preached the sermon, so that was amazing. Thank you. Thank you so much. So I invite us to dig a little deeper, look a little closer, move a little forward to what God is calling us to do. Take the time, if you will, to imagine with me this morning that you are sitting on the edge of a very vast field. And stretched out before you, you see this field, and in that field there are sheep scattered all across the green expanse. And in the distance, there is a lone shepherd standing there, watching over his flock with tender care. This scene mirrors the loving relationship between Jesus Christ and his church, between Jesus Christ and those who follow him. This morning, we continue delving into the heart of what true Christian living looks like. And we do that by continuing to look at our little book that I hope you all have, Reuben Job's small book entitled A Wesleyan Way of Living. If you do not have a copy of this, or if you want a copy of this, there are copies in the gathering room. I don't know, they're $6 or $7, something like that. What now? $8. All right. Well, I was rounding down for once instead of rounding up. All right. Or if you don't have that on you, just take one, honor system, and put a little extra in to cover that. But we are using this as a resource to help us look at this principle of doing good. It's a challenging call upon our life. Because at first, when we hear the words to do good, we think, oh, that's easy. But then Reuben Job says, do good to your enemies. Do good to those who hurt you. Do good to those who might not wish well for you. And we're asking ourselves, how do we do that? It's a challenging, challenging call to us, but it is one that is deeply rooted in the teachings of Jesus Christ. And this is the second part in this three-week series. Last week, Fawn shared with you thoughts around do no harm. And this week, I will share do good. And next week, we will pull all that together by hearing the words to stay in love with God. So how do we do good? We can best continue by looking through the lens of the two scriptures that you have heard. First of all, Fawn and Renee did a reflection on the 1 John passage. And I shared with you the gospel lesson from John 10. In John 10, Jesus identifies himself as the good shepherd, as the one who lays down his life for his sheep. And just as the shepherd protects and cares for his flock, Jesus also selflessly sacrifices himself for us. This sacrificial love is not limited to those who are easy to love. We are called to extend that love even to our enemies. This commandment to love. It moves further into 1 John, the third chapter, when we hear John echoing this sentiment in his letter, emphasizing the sacrificial nature of love, that we are called to lay down our lives for one another just as Jesus did for us. And that genuine love is not merely expressed in words, but it's expressed in deeds, especially when we extend it to those who oppose us. I'm very thankful for this Wesleyan way of living, but I would also like to just put it down, leave it alone, and say to Mary Stewart, why did you make us do that anyway? Just kidding, Mary Stewart. I just thought I'd throw it off on you. But in this Wesleyan way of living to do good, Reuben Job, in his explanation of a Wesleyan way of living, emphasizes a very practical application of this principle in our daily lives. He says that doing good is not just a suggestion, that it is a mandate for followers of Christ. And that includes showing kindness and mercy and forgiveness to all, even those who may consider themselves our enemies. We are reminded in this text to model what our Father John Wesley taught us when he said, I too will determine every day that my life will always be invested in the effort to bring healing instead of hurt, wholeness instead of division, harmony with the ways of Jesus instead of the ways of the world. Some of you may not be old enough to remember the story of Corrie ten Boom, but those of us who are a little more seasoned have heard of her on our journey. Corrie ten Boom was a Dutch Christian who, during World War II, helped Jews escape the Nazis. And despite facing unimaginable persecution, she forgave those who captured her, and she even prayed for them. Corrie ten Boom's actions exemplify what we're talking about in a Wesleyan way of living, as she chose to do good, even in the face of great adversity. And so, as I always ask, and so what about us? What about me? How do we apply this to our everyday lives? Let me ask you a question. Have you ever struggled to extend goodness to someone who has hurt you? Have you ever struggled to extend goodness to those who have hurt the ones that you love? Let's be honest with each other. We all have, haven't we? We've all had those times in our life when our hearts were hurting. And we were afraid maybe that our goodness would not be accepted if we offered it. Well, then again, I invite us to hear this. The truth is that the gift of goodness may be rejected, ridiculed, or misused. But my desire to do good is not limited by the thoughts and actions of others. My desire to do good should be in response to God's invitation for me to follow the way of Jesus Christ. We are called to have the image of God freshly stamped on our hearts. Stamped on our hearts so that it will lead us to the decision to do all the good we can for everyone that I can, for as long as I can. See, these first two rules, do no harm and do good, are extremely important. But we know in our human condition that it's hard for us to do that. It's hard for us to do no harm. It's hard for us to do good. But the good news is that we're not alone on this journey. And that leads us into next week, where we find the tool to help us live this way. And that tool is to stay in love with God. And by doing that, we are equipped to live out a Wesleyan way of living. I want to invite you to do something this week. If I were a teacher, I would say, I want to give you some homework. And that is that I would love for you to go somewhere, sit down, and be quiet for a while. Now, this is not something that is new to us. How many of you, when you were growing up, heard your mother say, you just need to get somewhere and sit down? You just need to get somewhere and sit down. Share with you that most of you know that for the last 2 weeks I have been on leave, and I have taken this time to try to be very close to God. I had the wonderful gift of a couple of people in the church offering to me a place of solitude, a place to get away. And in two particular places I was able to go and just sit. It's not always easy for me to sit, to be quiet. I was tempted through that time to work on things, even though I was not at work and I was asked to detach myself from that. It was a struggle. But as best I could, I was quiet. And I was alone. Fawn only came about a day and a half to stay with me during that period. But I spent a lot of time just sitting, quiet, looking out over the water, praying, meditating. And I don't really know how to say this, just kind of doing nothing, it felt like to me at times. But it was something. Or in the midst of that quietness, in the midst of that time alone, in the midst of pulling away from the world, the Good Shepherd came and tended to my soul. The Good Shepherd came and helped to heal some of my brokenness. My friends, I'm not the only one that has ever experienced that. I look out at you, and I know some of you have life stuff going on. Please, I offer you that gift. Take time to be alone with God. Don't feel like you have to make decisions. Don't feel like you have to be busy. Don't feel like you have to be praying even during that time. Your spirit is praying and your spirit is yearning. And God hears you. May that gift shepherd your soul as it did for me. And so, as followers of Christ, we are called to emulate the Good Shepherd, laying down our lives for others and extending love even to our enemies. With that thought in mind, please pray with me. Heavenly Father, empower us to live out a Wesleyan way of living, to do good even when it is difficult. Heavenly Father, come and fill us with your love so that we may extend that love to all, even to those that it is difficult to extend it to. Give us what we need. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Invite us to respond today by offering to God a portion of those gifts that have been given to us. I also invite us to use this time to come, if you would like, and kneel, to light a candle, to be quiet, to be alone with God. Our time is good. You have time to do that. Give to God what God is calling you to do. Won't you come?
Face shine upon you and be
Amen. Would you stand, please?
I invite you to hear these familiar words of John Wesley as we leave today.
Do all the good you can by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, and in all the places that you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Christ the solid rock, I stand all the ground.